All right, before I start with any high-level concepts, I actually want to cover a few examples of what objects and classes look like. And the idea is that, for example, I have here a simple console application, and we are already very used to the concept of like writing console dot and then getting write line as a method that allows me to print things up to the screen, right? So, for example, hello classes, and then I open and close, and then I can run this code and this shows up here on the screen, right? However, let's take a closer look at what we have done here, because indeed, it turns out that we haven't really discussed what the this console thing that I have here is, right? And if you look closely, when I type console and I type dot, what Visual Studio is giving me is this suggestion of a list of things that are inside of this console, whatever this is, right? And you can see that there are some different things. So, for example, I have like the wrench icon here, and I have this kind of like purple cube kind of thing, all right? And I can choose between a lot of different stuff, right? This is a good example of what I mean by complex data structures that encapsulate inside of them a lot of properties and a lot of functionality. So the idea is that console is something that is given to us within the C# environment, is part of the system library that we have here. And we never question it, but somewhere in the code, someone has created something that is called console, and which inside of it has the possibility of writing a line, writing another line, reading a key, and it has like all this really cool functionality that allows me to interface with the console window. All right. We've given that for granted, but it turns out that this console thingy is actually an object. It's not really an object, it's actually a class, but I will get to that later. Let's think about this as an object right now, okay? And it is an object because it incorporates inside of it a bunch of functionality. So it has all these methods, for example, write line, write, simple write, it has read key, etc., which allow me to create or do something, right? Now there I can choose console write line. I can choose, for example, what is this? Let me see. If I choose one of the wrenches, for example, this tells me what the background color is. And this is not a function, this is a property, right? So for example, I have the console background property, and because this is not a function, this is a property, I can actually read this from the console. So I can say, let me store this as a console color object, console color, and then store this here. And then let me actually print that console write line. Let's print the background color and let's see how this works. All right. And you see that I get here the black output. All right. Similarly, you might be used to, for example, the math object. So you can see that the math object, if I click dot, I get access to a lot of functionality. So, for example, calculating the square root of the value of, I don't know, 25, right? And I can print that to the console, right? Or something that I can also do. This is a function that is contained inside of math. Something that I can also do is I can print line the value of, for example, of pi. And you can see that in this case, pi is not a function, it's just a number, right? So I don't have to call it with the open and close parentheses. I just execute it. I just read it right away. All right. So what I want to say with this is that you can see how convenient it is in this case that the system is already giving us these two things, the console object and the math object. Again, they're not really objects, they're classes, but I will talk about that later. And how each one of these objects contains things that it can do. So the object can write things to the console, and then we can access that functionality. Or the object contains values. So the object contains the value of pi, the object contains the value of the background color of the console, etc., right? And This is very convenient because if we were to, if the fact that this functionality or these properties are inside of this object is a very good way of keeping things tidy and making sure that we don't have like 17 million different variables in my scopes with the value of the background color, a function called write line. Everything is contained inside of the object that actually uses this functionality for the same for math. So you can think of, for example, of the math object as a very complex structure that contains a lot of functionality, mathematical functionality, and some properties, the value of pi, the value of e, you know, those kind of things. So it turns out that this is very convenient because it makes storing and keeping things very clean, very tidy, and it's much easier to understand and to read. If I only had a write line function, then what the hell does that mean? But to me, as a human, it's a bit easier to understand that if I do console.writeline, it means that I'm writing a line to the console object. Or if I'm calculating the square root, it's a mathematical operation. So this hierarchy is actually not just easier to understand and to use, but it's also very convenient to keep programs clean, tidy, and things encapsulated wherever they should be belonging to. So this idea of creating structures that contain properties like the value of pi and functionality like being able to calculate a square root or being able to print to the console, this idea is core to what object-oriented programming means. And I'm going to show you in these videos how to actually create our own classes, our own objects, and be able to create functionality representing data structures representing this idea of encapsulation, all right? So let's take a look at what that means from a higher level perspective, from a more theoretical perspective, if you will.